Today we have the great privilege of meeting Professor Moise Brawer from Tel Aviv University in Israel. Professor Brawer is one of the founders of geography as a discipline in the universities of Israel. His father was in fact the very first geographer in Israel. Since then, he has been editor of encyclopedic works on Encyclopedia Hebraica. He has produced many atlases and maps, and we have just heard at this Congress his interest in the rabbinical literature and the sources that are available now for a renewed understanding of the Middle East. He has worked both with Arab and Jewish subjects, and in a way he is the best living source, I think, living on the spot on Jewish-Arab relationships from a geographic point of view. Anyhow, I want to go back to the beginning, Moise. And I know you were born in Vienna, but came to Israel as a little boy and grew up in Jerusalem in those years of 1920s and 30s. What was it like to grow up in that environment?
Well, I came to Jerusalem as a baby, a few months old, so I can not recollect the voyage from Vienna to Palestine, to Israel, and perhaps the first years of my life in Jerusalem. But if I dig back into my earliest recollections, I have pleasant and gloomy memories. It was a very interesting period. It was a period during which Jerusalem underwent very rapid changes. It expanded, it grew, many new buildings, many new roads, many new facilities. The town underwent changes under the impact of the British administration, which tried to the best of its ability to equip the town with modern services. The large influx of Jewish immigration, which came from many countries, but also a movement of Arabs from the neighborhood, especially from the vicinity of Hebron, who were attracted to Jerusalem in view of the great opportunities to find employment and the comparatively higher standard of living insofar as the regions from which they came. Now, to give you an example, when I was a little child, there was no water supply in Jerusalem, and I can remember my mother going twice or three times a week to a certain place where water was actually given out in sort of jerry cans, and the amount of water which she could carry home was the quantity on which we depended for 2 or 3 days. Occasionally, we hired somebody to bring the water, but there was a very severe water shortage. And to the great joy of many people, in the late 20s, a modern water supply was gradually provided to expanding parts of the town. So that at a later stage in my childhood, the water problem has actually changed its character. The same applies to transportation. At the beginning, there were horse-drawn carts. I can remember the first buses in Jerusalem. But later on, of course, the carts disappeared. The famous diligence of the Turkish period, which was still internal transportation in the middle 20s, was completely replaced by the late 20s and early 30s by buses, taxis, and so on. And the same applies to many other facilities. I mean, in the early 30s, we got electricity. Before that, as a child, I used to make my homework to the light of a petroleum lamp or candles, which, of course, at that time, there was no alternative. Then, when the electric light came, it was a great improvement. And of course, conditions insofar as many other aspects of services and life improved very rapidly. On the other hand, the political strife gave its impact on my childhood. I can remember when I was the age of 8, we were living outside Jerusalem in one of the suburbs, or actually an outlying suburb surrounded by Arab villages. Riots broke out, and our house was attacked. We at night we had to leave the house while the on one side bullets were penetrating into the rooms, and my late sister has actually been somehow indirectly injured. She lost or her hearing was impaired as a result of a bullet which struck the wall within millimeters of her ear. At night we fled from our home, which was then partly burned, and we had to become refugees in the center of Jerusalem, because that part of Jerusalem, Western Jerusalem, which we lived, was evacuated, was looted, and partly destroyed in connection with political disturbances that broke out. This was the 1929. But on the whole, I mean, leaving out some of these unpleasant and sometimes frightening episodes, life was very interesting, and it's not only looking back, but at the time, things looked, even to a child, as I would say, messianic times. The sudden changes, the enormous amount of building, of new people, of improvements. This by itself was very impressive. So that I don't know to what extent it had its effect on my character and of that of other children in my class or in my close vicinity and in the areas where I actually lived. But quite a number of them have, at later stage, given expression to these times. One of my classmates is a very famous poet and writer. Another was also a writer. Another classmate of mine became the commander-in-chief of the Israeli army. So that it had its, I would say, although I have never tried to establish to what extent one can sort of attribute these, I would say, stormy times, or attribute the nature of the impact of these stormy times on our character and on our career later on.
Yes, it's very hard to say. But what you studied at the university, at the Hebrew University, had nothing to do with politics or social movements. It was physics and mathematics and geology. So your choice of university theme had, it seems to me, very little to do with your childhood experience.
That's correct. But I became geographer, I think, as soon as I could speak, understand, and especially grasp things. My father was a geographer. He was a student of Penck. He studied at Vienna University, and his geographical conceptions and experience were those of the Viennese school of the early years of the present century. And he used to take me around on his field studies and expeditions. And so that from a very early age, I think from the age of 4 or 5, I could already identify the various rock formations and a good number of geographical features and phenomena, and had quite a good knowledge of a number of processes which are, I would say, conspicuous in the formation of the landscape of Palestine, of Israel. I took those subjects at the Hebrew University because there was no department of geography at the time, so that my geographical education was actually provided at home. I worked with my father later, in later years, when I was already, a teenager. I did work with my father in cartographic work, on, also in his geographical studies and field work, so that I had some experience. And the study of geology and physics and mathematics indirectly, of course, fed these, let's say, homemade education as a geographer, as soon as possibility arose to study geography where geography existed, the department, I did so by traveling to England.
Yes, but first it was about wartime, World War II, when you finally, when you did your degree at the Hebrew University. How did World War II affect you, think?
Well, I did not conclude my studies at the Hebrew University, because at that time it was impossible to get a degree even in geology, and to get a degree in physics or mathematics was beyond my aims. So I concluded a certain, I would say, curriculum, which I assumed to be the most suitable background for further studies in geography and geology, and I left it at that. I entered the world of journalism in order to make a living, and worked in what was at that time the Palestine Post, an English newspaper which appeared in Jerusalem, and at one of the Hebrew papers, and I was in charge of Arab affairs. Speaking Arabic and having good connections with Arabs, I grew up in an area which is surrounded by Arab villages, that we have daily, almost daily contact with our Arab neighbors, except at periods of high tension, so that I was in charge of Arab affairs, and I had quite good contacts with Arab leadership and various people who were prominent in the cultural and political life of the Arab community in Jerusalem, until 1944, when I became war correspondent and went to Europe. And I served as war correspondent for the Israeli papers, I mean, these, at the time they were Palestinian papers, in the last few months of the war. I went into Germany with the 8th Army, the British 8th Army, and the American 3rd Army, and saw the fall of Germany the last 2 weeks. Later on, in the same capacity, I covered the a number of the war crime trials, the Belsen trial and the Nuremberg trials, but I left that, went to London, into the University of London, in order to continue and conclude my studies, although I continued to support myself from London by working for the same newspapers.
So you arrived at London just after World War II, to King's College. What do you remember from that time? Who were the people that influenced you?
Well, the person, or academically, had his deepest impression on me was Wooldridge. Although at the time when I arrived in the first period, the head of the department was Professor Gordon, who was actually a geologist. There was a combined department of geology and geography at, at King's College. But later he retired, and Wooldridge became the head of the department. But even before that, I was already very deeply impressed by him. I went out with him on field work, and was very closely attached to his work during my studies, because I felt that I could actually learn and be inspired by him, perhaps more than any other member of the teaching staff of King's College at the time. And I was indeed very deeply impressed by the thoroughness, by his tenacity, and by the way in which everything that he did, he tried to get the best, as much as human capacity could achieve, although he was not sometimes not a very pleasant person, but this perhaps was also an attraction, and I look back on the years during which I worked under him, because I did also my master's thesis under him, and although on his advice I wrote my PhD not on a geomorphological theme, but on a geographical, human, and political team. But he advised me and actually directed me along certain part of the systematic way, and also introduced me to people who are very helpful to me in my studies. But obviously, there were other people in the department with whom I had contacts, whose lectures and seminars I attended, and who definitely have a good share in my geographical education, such as Professor Dudley Stemp, Professor Spate, who gave a brilliant lecture on the Middle East and South Asia, and Professor Harrison Church, whose lectures are on Africa and on France I admired. They were so well and logically constructed that sometimes today when I teach, the back of my mind I go to the manner in which he constructed his lectures in regional geography. Being in London by itself, you know, using the libraries, having the facilities for academic work was certainly a very great advantage, which up to the present day I cannot detach myself from. And almost on every holiday and sabbatical, if I can, I go back to London to the same libraries, and many of the works which I have done over the last years are actually connected with my visits to London. As a matter of fact, I am now working on a new book which depends very largely on material which I find in libraries and archives in England, especially in London.
Yes, well, we'll come back to this book in a moment, but when you returned to Israel then, after doing your PhD, you spent many years not teaching geography, but doing editorial work for the Encyclopedia Hebraica. Did that mean, did you feel that you were being denied something of the teacher in you, or did you enjoy just being a scientist?
The point is that the Hebrew University had already a department of geography, which is a small department, and was not able to employ me. So that I had no possibility to give expression to my academic tendency within the framework of a department of geography. I did some teaching in teachers' colleges and in extramural studies, what was in Tel Aviv called the popular university, but most of my work was editorial. I edited the geographical part of most volumes of the Encyclopedia Hebraica. The Encyclopedia Hebraica is a work on the dimensions of the Encyclopedia Britannica. It actually extends over 32 volumes, out of which nearly 20 volumes, or in 20 volumes, nearly 20 volumes, I edited or was responsible for the geography. I mean, I also initiated the contacts with people who wrote various articles of various themes in various, not only in Israel, but in various parts of the world. And I edited these articles, and of course did everything that was connected, such as ordering and editing maps, and also pictures and everything that was connected. Yes. But during that period, I was still partly working in one of Israel's daily newspapers. I was, in fact, foreign editor and leader writer in this newspaper. I used that period to produce four atlases in Hebrew, which are, I think, the most extensive and advanced atlases ever produced in Hebrew, which became, in fact, almost a household book or property all over Israel. This I did in cooperation with the Geographical Institute Herzl in Vienna. And up to the present day, one of the atlases, the high school atlas, has already been published in 24 editions.
Oh, I have heard this, that in Israel the name Brawer is associated with this atlas.
Yes, there are many atlases. Yes, in fact, I edited an atlas of the Middle East, which is indirectly, I don't want to be arrogant and boast, become the source material for many atlases in Middle East countries, Arabic and other, who actually drew the thematic maps, climatic, economic, and other, from that atlas, which Professor Yehuda Carmon of the Hebrew University and myself prepared in the late 50s and early 60s. This atlas was also published already in 8 editions, and is one of the few works which you can find in Hebrew work, which you can find in libraries in Arab universities. They openly order this atlas through bookshops in England or in Italy, because they use it. So until opportunity arose to enter or re-enter academic life, I busied myself with, say, indirect geographical work. I did not do much research during that period.
But maybe that is the thing for which you will be most grateful in the end, because it had such wide diffusion. But yes. Our time is short, so I want you to tell me now what it was like when you were first invited to establish the Department of Geography at Tel Aviv University.
Well, I was not invited to establish the department. I was invited to teach two courses in geography. One, regional geography of the Middle East for the Department of Middle East Studies, which became a compulsory course for students of that department, and another on, I would say, geographical aspects of developing countries, mainly the human geographical aspects in a department of developing countries. But as soon as I sort of got my first foothold in the young University of Tel Aviv, which was in its actually first year as a recognized university, I started to fight for the establishment of the Department of Geography, and must say that did not meet with the sympathy and support of the leaders of most disciplinary departments which existed at that time. Some, especially on the natural sciences, in meetings of the Senate and the Executive Committee, argued that there is no need to have a Department of Geography because geography is not a discipline. It's a compilation of things. I mean, these arguments.
Yes.
However, a director at the time, who was an historian, an expert in classical studies, took a positive view, and after doing much groundwork and endeavoring to influence many people, especially members of the Faculty of Medicine, who knew nothing about geography, but thought that they must support some pioneering effort, a decision was taken to establish the department, and I was appointed to organize it.
So you had the support of history and medicine?
Yes.
But now these are the 60s.
You see, the founder of the Faculty of Medicine and the first head of the faculty was a great friend of my father, a personal friend, and also somehow related. And in fact, brought the support of the Faculty of Medicine to a very large extent. He was an outstanding personality in the development of medical services in Israel, so that he also threw about his personality this matter. But we encountered very tough opposition, and up to the present day, whenever matters connected with the Department of Geography arise, I mean, any expansion, any additional fields, the same people, some of them are outstanding scholars, internationally known in their fields, say, well, I told you, geography has no place in the university. Now don't make things worse by expanding it or by opening new venues for geography.
But you have persisted. And I wondered if your ground ideology, as it were, was a kind of geography a la Woolbridge, a la Dudley Stamp, or a la Brawer, Senior?
No, I think that whether I intentionally or subconsciously, I brought with me the British school. Mm-hmm. And I built the curriculum and the training of the geographers in my department very much modeled on the British school, and I am very glad I did so. Although it is not on the contemporary British school, and since I established the department, many years have passed, over 20 years. But I'm glad because it really gave a good foundation, and we could utilize the British experience, British textbooks, and a good many other facilities which were already well, I would say, run in and well used, so that we knew exactly their effects and how they combine, how the coordination is actually achieved. So I wasn't doing really a very original structure of the department and of the curriculum. I adapted it to Israeli requirements and to the, I would say, the spirit of a young university which prevailed at Tel Aviv at the time.
Okay, so it was, by British, I presume you mean Woolridge?
Woolridge, yes, and a few others, I mean. Who.
And was it the same philosophy underlying the founding of the Bar-Ilan University?
Yes, a year later, I used to lecture one lecture in geography, sort of cultural geography, at Bar-Ilan University. And a year later, they asked me, although I was already fully preoccupied with the Tel Aviv University, if I could organize for them the Department of Geography at Bar-Ilan, and I did so. So I used actually to divide my time between these two departments. The rector at Bar-Ilan University at the time was a colleague of mine. We were students at the same time at King's College in London on the same floor. He studied history and I geography, so we knew each other since those days. It was he who gave the green light and the full support for the organization of the department. It was initially a smaller department and remained, and it is somewhat structured on different line because the requirements as laid down by the leadership or the management of Bar-Ilan were somewhat different from the more, I would say, freedom, liberal approach of the Tel Aviv University. But in the final end, this is a fully developed Department of Geography. I left the department only 7 years ago when being elected Dean of the Faculty of Humanities, I couldn't much longer carry the burden of even acting as advisor and as the senior member in the Department of Geography at Bar-Ilan. But the people who in the meantime were taken into the department were fully capable to look after it.
Yes. So I see that you have had much administrative responsibility, being chairman of departments, founding of departments, now dean of humanities, but you also had time to travel. You have traveled abroad.
I traveled very extensively.
And can you describe what has been significant about those travels for you?
Well, I don't know when you want me to begin the travel. I was taken by my father already at the age of 5 to Egypt, and we had a kind of a geographical excursion of Egypt. He also took me to other areas. I traveled to Europe. I wrote my first essay, geographical essay, at the age of 7 for a school paper on Venice. After visiting Venice, and a year later I wrote an essay which was published also in the school paper on Vienna. So I traveled very extensively already in my childhood, visited quite a number of Mediterranean countries, mainly in Austria, Switzerland, and Italy, and so on. But in my adult life, and I was on graduation, I was actually given by an uncle a kind of, I would say, a prize, which I used to travel along the Danube. I traveled from Vienna along the Danube to Budapest, Belgrade, Romania, Black Sea, and then from the Black Sea through Istanbul back to Palestine. This was shortly before the war in 1938. And in my capacity as war correspondent, I traveled through parts of North Africa and Europe, Italy. I was in Gibraltar just before the end of the war, and then in Europe. And since then, I've traveled also as part of my academic career. Yes. I was visiting professor in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and during that period, I explored, if one may say so, traveled extensively, especially during weekends and breaks in the central part of the United States. Then I was visiting professor in Ottawa, so I traveled up to Hudson Bay, to Labrador, in the eastern part of Canada, and then I was visiting professor in New Zealand, so I traveled up and down New Zealand and quite a few of the Pacific Islands, Fiji, Tonga, the Gilberts, and so on, and so on. I mean,
so was it the landscapes of these different areas that was the primary interest?
And the people.
Yeah, people living on the soil, as it were.
Yes.
But it had more of a geographical appeal than,
yes,
say, intellectual theory discussion and so on.
Yes, it has.
Yes.
I mean, as time went by, I got more and more interested in special topics. So in my travels, I mean, in addition to being something like a tourist with a geographical background, I also concentrated on acquiring knowledge on those topics which interest me, so that more and more my tours became focused on special matters.
Okay.
And then, of course, came a period when I already used these tours for research purposes, or where I was called to participate in geographical surveys and to sort of, I wouldn't say guide, but be one of the guides in aerial study works as a preparation or as a background to development work.
Yes, yes, that's another very strong interest of yours,
yes,
rural geography and,
yes,
developing societies.
I've worked on this. You see, again, here, my experiences in rural geography go back to my childhood when my father, who had a great, I would say, attraction to Arab villages.
But in addition to travels and administrative responsibilities, I know, Moise, that you have cultivated a whole cluster of fascinating research interests. You mentioned a book you were about to write. Can you develop?
I am writing a book on the Arab village in Israel or in Palestine, which I believe, I mean, the Arab village, not the book, is one of the most fascinating features of human geography, not only in the Middle East, but in world geography, because there is so much that it incorporates, especially in a country like Israel with a very long history, with the fact that many of these Arab villages stand on the same sites on which settlements existed thousands of years ago, and sometimes even bear the same names. And there is so much human experience, initiative, and intuition embodied in these villages that the more I go into the subject, I become more fascinated and become more involved. I employ my students. I've got, over the years, more than 400 seminar papers written by my students on Arab villages. Each one is an anatomy of a village, sometimes a comparative anatomy with other villages. And that by itself, the material collected by the students, because I keep only those seminar works which are of a reasonably good standard. Now, the Arab villages have undergone a very rapid transformation. There is no identity in the transformation because each village has got a lot of individuality which emanates both from its physical the characteristics and the attributes of its people, the economic background, and various other factors which in fact include the social structure, the particular historic and other aspects which make up the special identity of each village, so that the transformation processes, which are the result of technological progress, of the rapid economic growth of the country, of changes in the employment opportunities, and many other recent years developments, have different, I would say, venues of creating new faces for each village. And this by itself is also very interesting. Now we have examined these villages over the 20 years or more that I'm engaged in this at intervals of 5 to 6 years or 7 years, and found these differences, which provide us with geographical material from which we can draw conclusions on the nature of the processes which these villages undergo as part of the transformation of the rural areas. Now this work is, I would say, not concluded. The book will in fact deal with a certain phase, with the background, the history, up to the modern times, and then with the developments and the transformation processes until the early 80s. I hope that if I am not able to carry on with this in 10 or 15 years' time, somebody will examine the new phases or the development which have taken place and follow up on the work which I have been doing and which I do. I employ my students, and sometimes my colleagues are very critical of the fact that I make the students devote so much time to examining the villages, and under the political conditions which exist in Israel today, especially in what is known as the occupied areas, it sometimes puts the students in what is considered as, I would say, danger, a certain amount of danger. Though in my entire work since the early 60s, we haven't had a single incident where any student or myself was not only, I would say, attacked, but ill-treated in any way. And you can understand that, for instance, if I send a girl student to an Arab village, sometimes her parents are very annoyed and think that I'm unnecessarily putting their daughter to a certain amount, or exposing her to a certain amount of danger of being molested, if not physically attacked. But I must say that in all this experience, the villagers have always treated my student and myself with great courtesy and hospitality, so that from that point of view, the work was not only hindered by the existing political conditions, but always found the welcome spirit, the traditional Arab hospitality spirit, which strangers enjoy in such villages.
And you have had Arab students as well as Jewish
students. I have Arab students, and I have had also non-Jewish students who came to Israel on some, I would say, special courses of their respective universities. They were sent for some, I would say, special training with us in preparation for their doctoral work or any other. We have had a number of non-Israeli students in this work.
I know that you have also another book called The Boundaries of Israel, and I wish we had time to go into all of that, but what I would really like to hear from you is what you presented at the Congress here, the International Congress, on rabbinical literature as resource of, for insight into the geography of the Eastern Mediterranean. Would you like to say something more about that?
Yes, in my, again, you see, we always go back to my roots, to my younger days. In my younger days, I was actually given very large doses of rabbinical literature, both in the high school, in which I studied, which was a religious school, and laid great emphasis on the rabbinical literature, and also at home. My father was a modern geographer, but he was a religious man. He was actually trained as a rabbi. And so that I absorbed a large amount, which I did not use much, or at least not directly. In recent years, and especially going through the large amount of material that my deceased father, my late father, left, I got tempted to go into this. And I found the vast wealth of rabbinical literature, especially post-biblical literature, from the 3rd century to the 11th or 12th century. There is so much geography scattered in, I would say, crumbs of information, conceptions, of explanations, descriptions, which if put together can provide a very interesting and perhaps complete picture of geographical knowledge and conceptions during a period which has not provided much other material. This is the post-classical period after the Roman and post-Roman geography and before the upsurge of Arab scholarly activities which involved also exploration and geographical literature, also interwoven in philosophy, history, and so on. So I started to go into this, and to my, I would say, a pleasant surprise, I found very interesting descriptions, especially on the Mediterranean countries, because you have to realize that the Jewish diaspora in those periods was concentrated around the Mediterranean in what we call Babylonia or Mesopotamia, Western Iran of today, in Syria and Palestine, Israel, and around the Mediterranean, slowly expanding and reaching already in the 6th century Spain. And there was a great interchange of correspondence, mainly on religious themes, between centers of learning and small Jewish communities which were faced with various problems. And within that correspondence, you also find much geographical, I would say, knowledge, conceptions, and explanations, sometimes directly connected with the problems raised, but sometimes completely marginal and irrelevant. And I don't know exactly how sometimes the people came to mentioning these things, because it looks completely irrelevant. And I'm trying now, as soon as I will finish the two books which you mentioned, the book on the Arab village should be ready within a few months, and the book on the boundaries of Israel is nearly ready. So I will devote myself more to this subject, and perhaps help in that way by being acquainted with these sources to bridge the gap between the classical Roman period and the Arab period, and then the post-Arab, you know, the exploration, the renaissance of science in Europe. I would like just to mention that this type of geographical knowledge, both descriptive, informative, and conceptions, is not confined to the rabbinic literature of that period. It is also present in early Christian literature of the Eastern churches. I discovered this through, I would say, coincidental talks with friends or people who are members of these communities and who have some knowledge of the liturgy and the, I would say, the religious and perhaps other literature, such as the Syrian church, you know, the ancient Syrian church, the Coptic church, and the Armenian church. Mm-hmm. When in Ethiopia, on a visit a few years ago, I bought in the market a page which looked to me old, and it turned out to be ancient, of a Bible in ancient Ethiopian language, Gez. And I brought it back with me to Jerusalem, and a colleague of mine read that page, and to my extreme surprise, there was a description in that page of the road along the Red Sea to Palestine from Ethiopia, giving some advice on the season and the sites to be chosen as stations. It appears that the work from which this page was stolen was known to a professor in ancient Ethiopian languages in Los Angeles. But for me, it was a discovery, and I'm trying to follow that up by people who can read that language and who may find additional sources for geographical information in that Coptic literature. I'm also trying to make an Armenian friend interested in exploring this theme in Armenian literature, in early Armenian literature.
Well, it sounds like a fascinating endeavor and an endless one. And your career certainly has touched on so many diverse and rich areas. I'm very grateful that you came to speak with us today, and I wish you all the very best energy and inspiration on these books, as well as on the rabbinical literature, because I think you are sitting in a very crucial situation to promote better mutual understanding between the diverse peoples of the Eastern Mediterranean. And I know you've done a lot so far.
It was a pleasure answering your questions, and may I return you the compliment that your knowledge of all these various fields of geography made it possible for you to guide me in this interview in a, I would say, most instructive way, because otherwise, without your very, I would say, talented guidance, I would have been lost to so many subjects.
Let's see what questions you get when people look at it.